Hi, it's so nice to be here. I heard you're ridiculously happy. Is this true? Like, some people came early just to hang out, and many of you are never leaving in order to just hang out. So I'm really proud of the school to have pulled this together. I know that this is one of the first times you've had this type of conference. So anyway, thank you for being here, and it's a pleasure to be here as well. So I'm going to talk a little bit about power of story, but I'm going to foreshadow a couple of other bodies of research that we've been doing recently, mostly because it's really fun for me to talk about the research. So I wanted to start off with a recent study that I ran with some co-authors. And this was using a large data set of 12 million data points. It's called the We Feel Fine data set. And what my co-author, Sepp Kumbhar, and his colleague, Jonathan Harris, did was write a computer algorithm that combed the blogosphere for all mentions of I feel and I am feeling. And so, because blog-based data has demographic data that you can scrape, they were able to, in a single slide, basically document what people are feeling at what ages. And so this is a data set that was collected over 3 years, a cross-cultural data set, 12 million data points in a single slide. And the way to read this particular slide is we start out simple. So how many of you have sort of 11 to 14-year-olds? Raise your hand. Okay, so when you ask, like, how are you feeling, they say, fine. Like, what'd you do today? Nothing, all day, I did nothing. It's been, 12 hours and I did nothing. So there's not this rich emotional lexicon associated with this teen. But we soon fill up with angst. At 15 to 18, they start to feel very anxious. When they do feel happy, we show that what they mean is they feel excited, which is a very angsty form of happiness. And then feelings of confinement around 21, they start to feel not very well understood or known until we leave those feelings behind to go conquer the world. At 25, they start to feel a little bit more powerful. The meaning of happiness equates more to feeling hopeful, optimistic, that you could have money, power, or status, or that you might already start to have it. The meaning of happiness is much more associated with, like, sort of satisfaction or pride in what you're doing. And then we gradually trade those feelings for around ambition for balance. So around 30, people start to blog about losing balance, needing more balance. They haven't seen their families or worked out in a long time. Then they develop an appreciation for their physical body, start talking about how they feel sort of fat or unhealthy, because, again, all of a sudden their bodies went downhill without them knowing at age 35. And then we start blogging about our children. We're only as happy as our least happy child, an evolving sense of connectedness around 40, for which we feel happy, calm, blessed, and grateful. And so the meaning of happiness migrates from excitement to feelings of sort of satisfaction and pride to feelings of balance, and then migrating to feelings of impact and then connectedness or peacefulness. And this is important for a few reasons. One is, and by the way, it's not that people die when they're 60, it's just that the blog-based data is not as large. There's not a ton of 60-year-old bloggers. These sample sizes are huge. And so this data set's interesting for a couple reasons. One is that I always give this data set, usually to my students teaching the Power of Story class, so that they mine the data in order to tell the story with these large data sets, so that they debunk the feeling that story is this abstract, esoteric, touchy-feely thing, and that data is this hard, objective thing. But when you give people large data sets and they start to analyze them, they understand that data scientists are essentially storytellers. And so telling the story in the data becomes really important. And this slide does that. But the second reason I share it is because it really underscores some of the fallacies we have in our research on happiness. So some of our research on happiness, which has blossomed in the last 3 decades or so, shows that we often implicitly pursue happiness, that being happy is at the core of our decision making. So we're optimizing for some utility function. That utility function is usually happiness. You know, is this going to bring me happiness? But what our research shows is that even though we might pursue happiness, this work shows that once we achieve a certain sense of happiness, excitement, or satisfaction, or balance, or even impact, that the meaning of happiness migrates in these really systematic ways every 5 or 10 years. And so it questions this notion of, are we making decisions in the right way? What is well-being more generally? And how might we be making decisions for our organizations and our clients and our employees and our family if this sort of hedonic treadmill doesn't persist or is not the right model to be following? So our work shows that if you aim for meaning, something that's deeply meaningful or purposeful, people end up becoming much happier. Meaning and purpose is a pretty esoteric word. So what we do is we run studies to be able to parse what happiness is versus what meaning is. And so in one particular study, my co-authors and I wanted to dive into what creates a happy life versus a meaningful life. And we asked individuals, a large set of individuals across studies, simple questions like, do you believe you have a happy life? In general, are you happy? 1 to 7 Likert scale. And then we asked them, do you believe that you have a meaningful life? Again, the same type of scale. And so these two constructs are positively correlated. If you feel like you have a lot of happiness, you likely have a lot of meaning. About 0.5 variance is commonly explained. But if you partial out the positive covariance in these two constructs, and you just look at those individuals that say that they feel happy but not that meaningful, versus meaningful but not that happy, you get these huge differences in these two types of people. The first big difference is that the individuals who say that they are happy but don't have a meaningful life, they say that they want to feel good, they like to feel good all of the time, they like to feel very good and they don't want to feel bad. The meaningful individuals like to also feel good and report feeling good a lot of the time, but they also are not as concerned about never feeling negative affect. So they know that life is much more sort of a roller coaster, there's ups and downs, and that in fact defines life. The second biggest difference is that happiness is more about giving, getting, and it's more self-oriented. So our happiness individuals say that they think about themselves a lot, they like to receive gifts from others. The meaningfulness individuals really like to give to others. They're much more focused on reading the room, how are others feeling. They know that sort of how people remember you and what you did to them and how you made them feel is more important than what you get right now. And then the third biggest difference is that the individuals that rated themselves as happy, they're very focused on how they feel right now. And the meaningfulness individuals, they were much more focused on what the past meant, what the present means, and what the future means, and how these things work together. So the reason to share with you these stories is because I'm trying to make the case around meaning, which is important both in life but also at work. There's research to show that individuals that say that they feel meaning at work or feeling connected to purpose are not just 3 times more likely to stay, but 1.7 times higher in terms of ratings on job satisfaction and 1.4 times more engaged. So there's a real quantitative benefit for individuals feeling connected to work, which usually means 2 things, that they like the people they work with and that they feel that they're doing something that's truly impactful that might change the world. So how do you design for meaningfulness? And this is where we get into story. What we found in our research is that individuals and organizations that are designed for story tend to have much more meaning and individuals connected to purpose than organizations that don't. So what I'm going to do is talk about why story, shed a little light on the behavioral science of story, illuminate a couple of misperceptions of story, then I'll go into how to harness it, and then I'll talk about a few ideas of what I hope you do on Monday. So, and I should also give you a little personal insight. Well, there's 3. All right, first, so I'm an academic. I teach these different classes that Irv mentioned, and I would always get pretty good ratings, but every time I would teach a class, I would want to revamp it. So I would email my students, like from the prior year or the year before, saying, what did you remember from the class? I'd love to know because I'm going to revamp it for this year. And inevitably, people would respond saying, I don't remember anything. I remember I really liked your class. And also you have a funny shtick where, like, if someone has their phone ring, you make them pick it up in the middle of class, and that's hilarious. That killed. And so in 10 weeks of teaching these, like, different marketing classes, they only remembered, like, a funny joke that I would do on them, because that, you know, crushed. And so this is demoralizing, if you can't imagine, as a teacher, because pretty much your job is to teach. And if they're not remembering, that's problematic. And it made sense upon reflection. So I would run all of my classes, because I didn't want people to think that marketing was a soft subject. So I would run only analytics in my class. And in every class, I would cold call them and make sure that they ran regressions and break-evens and talked about serial correlation and multicollinearity. And they really got very advanced in their analytics, and they changed their perception of marketing, but we never got to anything else besides just, you better run all of your analyses. And so as I dove into the science of story, I realized that what happens is when people hear a story versus just data, that they're 22 times more likely to remember it over a long haul. And so what I was doing in my classes, just running analytics and not ever having these different sort of stories punctuate the points, is I was making it so that their experience was pretty positive, but they're not gonna remember anything. The second thing I should notice is, or mention, is I went to Berkeley for 2 years, about 6 years ago. I was hired there, and I usually don't really like private school and fancy people. I like public school. Who went to Berkeley? Anyone? Go Bears, three of you. And so I went to Berkeley. I was really excited to be there, and I didn't think I was going to come back. And so I went off, and I took a leave from here, and I taught this class called Creativity and Innovation. And one of the basic principles of this class is that you have to do things, you have to kind of reverse the rules. Whatever you've done in the past, consider doing the opposite of it, and then, or generating ideas that feel very opposite, and then trying those. And periodically, it's going to be a disaster, and but periodically, it's going to actually work out. So I tried to do this on my last lecture. My normal last lecture for these classes is, you know, I spend 40 hours and come up with a list of the top 10 things I hope they remember, and then I, you know, give it to them. This time I didn't do anything. I just asked my students, what did you remember from the class? All of my 60 students emailed me back, and they gave me basically bullets of insights. One of my students shared with me a story. And that story about how the class impacted him had such a dramatic impact on my life and my husband's life and my family's life that it completely changed the way that I parent, completely changed the way I spend my time. It completely changed the research trajectory that I was on, and it completely changed the way I teach. And now I'm much more thoughtful about story and how it works with data. So even though I'm going to be talking much more from a strategic level about the power of story, I wanted to share those two insights because from a very personal angle, these ideas around story have incredible potential to change not just how you run your organization, but also your life. So let me share a little bit about the behavioral science of story.
Once upon a time, information was scarce. So we made decisions based on the advice of experts, using them as North Stars for insights. Now, thanks to the internet, we can ourselves try and find our own answers to questions that plague us and find information to make informed decisions. But instead of finding clear answers, we often find noise. We're living in a world where we have too much information. And because of that, we're even more susceptible to great story. It's what helps us decide what to believe in. Stories are important because they're meaningful. And they're meaningful because they're memorable, impactful, and they personally connect. First, let's talk about memorability. Eugene O'Kelly was a CEO of a consulting company. He started having headaches. He was referred to a top neurosurgeon in New York, where he was diagnosed with late-stage brain cancer, and he was given 3 months to live. He started talking to his wife, how does he want to spend those 100 days? He was purposeful about who he spent time with and what stories to share with them. He also thought hard about what would be remembered in those last 100 days. He and his wife would live each day with a focus on finding perfect moments where time expands and when noise is separated from signal. All that exists is that single moment. And he found in those perfect moments, those were the most memorable stories that defined his life. In one study, researchers asked students to make a 1-minute persuasive pitch to other members in their class. And on average, a typical student used 2.5 statistics in their pitch. Only 1 in 10 told a story. 10 minutes later, the researcher asked everyone to pull out a sheet of paper and write down every single idea they remembered. Only 5% remembered any statistic. 63% of the students remembered the story. Stories are memorable in a way that statistics aren't. Now let me talk about impact. Research shows that individuals are more likely to buy from a person or an organization whose story they believe in and which resonates with them. In one study, Deb Small at the University of Pennsylvania and her colleagues wanted to determine how to best raise money for Save the Children, a charity focused on the well-being of children worldwide. They created 2 versions of a marketing pamphlet. The first version featured statistics about the magnitude of problems facing children in Africa. The second version also featured those statistics, but in addition provided information about Rokia, a 7-year-old girl from Mali, who faced the threat of severe hunger. The subjects were given $5 as compensation for the study, and before leaving, the researchers asked if they wanted to donate any money to the cause. The individuals in the story condition gave nearly twice as much money as those in the statistics condition. We used to think it was our rational brain that makes decisions. Now we know it's emotion driving decisions, and we rationalize the decision afterwards. Finally, I want to talk about personal connection. Research shows that if we present statistics to an audience, a certain part of the brain called the Broca's and Wernicke's area gets activated. So the language processing part of the brain is activated and we can understand but not feel. When a story is shared, the audience feels the story. Our whole brain is activated and meaning is extracted. The meaning of the story comes from the personal connection the audience feels when they're listening to the story. And when a story is well told, they're able to feel connected not just to the story, but to the storyteller. When most of us think of advocating for ideas, we go to statistics, we go to convincing arguments, facts, and figures. But studies show that if we share a story, people are more likely to remember the message, be persuaded by it, feel personally connected to it. And when data and stories are used together, audiences are moved both intellectually and emotionally. For lasting effect, you need to persuade the rational brain, but also resonate with the emotional brain. Recent behavioral research has shown why stories are so powerful. It's because they're meaningful. Those who tell the best stories will become the best leaders. If we consider the simple question, what is the story or why am I doing this? We may find we make very different choices of how we spend our time. Isabel Allende once wrote, "Silence before being born, silence after death. Life is nothing but noise between those 2 unfathomable silences." But there is signal and there is noise. And how do we reduce the noise? Story.
So good, really, just. It was very polite of you. So just to define a story, it's a narrative with a beginning, a middle, and an end. They have arcs. They're marked by these highs and these lows. But it's not just facts, features, lists, to-do lists. So meaning is captured in story, right? Because it's longitudinal, it's lasting, it has these highs, these lows, and it involves these characters. If you think about these arcs, it's stories when you're shaping it, you're telling people about something that might feel like a roller coaster. So if you think of, you know, movies that we see all the time, James Bond, the arc is always, what happened? I don't know. He gets the girl. And every single James Bond movie has the exact same arc. We had Jurassic Park, which was, I don't know if you remember, but, you know, what's going on, T-Rex? What's going on, big T-Rex? What's going on, really, really big T-Rex? So arcs don't have to be really sophisticated. They just have to, like, have volatility. And or Casablanca, which is known as one of the best well-crafted arcs in a movie, where these micro arcs that define the overall story arc. But the funny thing is, most people believe that stories are really these long, epic things, and oftentimes they can be quite cryptic. Ernest Hemingway was once known to have written one of the first six-word stories. He wrote, "Baby shoes for sale, never worn." So when I teach the Power of Story class, I ask the students before class to give me a story of, you know, anything they've written that they're proud of, or a six-word story. By the way, most all of them just send me their Stanford essays because they're so excited to use them again, because they worked so hard on them and never used them again, and they had these epic stories, right? Because everyone gets into Stanford, not because of their GPA or the SAT or GMAT, it's because of these stories, their essays and their recommendation, right? The stories are the differentiator. You're banking on people, joining their team, wanting them to come to place because of the stories that they tell and others tell about them. So, but I do make my students tell these six-word stories and write them and introduce each other to them. Here's a few. Not quite aspiring to be quite. Tonight he packs, tomorrow I pine. Married the wrong girl, fixed it. Getting old, ringtones pissing me off. So they don't have to be these big epic stories. They could be sort of a moment in time or something kind of innocuous, but it defines you. So I'm going to give you 30 seconds to write a six-word story about yourself. So take out a piece of paper. And just six-word story, 30 seconds. It could be funny or epic or meaningful. One tip is that ideally you've changed. So you used to be this and now you're that, because that kind of forces you to think in terms of an arc or some sort of transformation. So 30 seconds, six-word story. All right, now grab the person next to you or a couple of people, like get in groups of either two, three, or four, and just share the six-word story. You guys have 30 seconds to share your six-word story. All right, quickly. All right, finishing up. All right. Did anyone hear like an epic six-word story? Will you just point to the person who like said a six-word story? Could you stand up in the white or right around there? Yeah. Someone else nominate their something you heard. Come on. All right, in the red, you're willing. I want like five. Let's see. Back there, please stand up. You've been nominated. Congratulations. There's big awards. Oh, right there. Yes, in the blue. Come on, one more. Let's get a female. Let's go crazy. All right. Well, oh, we've got a female. Can you stand up? Thank you. All right. We got five people, I think, right? One, two, three, four, five. Awesome. Okay, so all you're going to do is someone in red is going to come over and grab and give you a mic. I think, are you not nominated? Thank you very much. Okay, so you're just gonna say your name to everyone and then your six-word story. We'll clap and you can sit down. All right.
Michael Mazzio. I left New York City, CXP, boom, done.
Nice. That might be more than six words, but seven-ish. Okay, great, let's, in the back.
Happy, old, and stressed, younger now.
What's you do? I know everyone knows you, but like.
What's my name?
Yeah, just like, I know everyone knows you.
Peter Kelly.
It's just like, yeah, just because, you know, It's polite. All right.
So Gerald Risk was wound up, then let go.
Fantastic.
I'm Lisandra Alves from Brazil. Built it, sold it, now what?
Right over here. Okay, you got it? Brett Forrester.
Found Neverland, never say never.
Oh, beautiful. Okay, any observations, like shout out any observations from those six word stories? Just like anything that surprised you? It's all about business? Yeah, they're pretty clear, so they contain a lot of meaning. They might be about business or career transition or whatever, but they also often feel quite personal. And for six words, actually communicate a lot of meaning. Any other observations?
They have happy endings.
Yeah, in America, we like those. Yeah, if I had more international people, I don't know. I think yours was a little bit less like, who knows what, now what? Might be happy, might be sad. But you're right, there's cultural definitions of arcs. Russians, for example, aren't quite as happy focused as we are. North Korea, I don't know, except anyway, I'm getting derailed. Yeah, observation? Yeah, like so half of them you're like, I get it, I understand you, say no more, and others are almost invitations to have more conversations. What we find, there's one study I never published, but we asked half of our executives at the beginning of a session to do the six-word story, and then the other half, I asked them at the end of the session, and we took metrics on how much they wanted to spend time together, whether they wanted to get a beer together, whether they wanted to work on a group project together. And the group that was exposed to this little short exercise at the very beginning were substantially closer and more intrigued to get to know each other than the people that didn't do that exercise. There's something about story that makes you feel more connected to others. And we could go on and on for all of the behavioral scientific reasons for that and the neuroscience behind that, but it's true, people feel closer. But it's also strategic. I recently did a session for Adam Silver, the NBA commissioner, and what we did was we got all 32 basketball teams in a room, very similar to this, and all 32 teams were in different rooms. And so you have your owners there, and you have all the top management, so about, like, let's say 10 or 12 people at each table. And we ran three different exercises, and I'll take you through them really quickly. But they're all six-word stories. Six-word stories about purpose. What's the team's purpose? What's its mission? What does it stand for? The second one was these user stories. How are you going to make your season ticket holder the hero of their own story? So it's not about you or the team or the NBA. It's about the customer. And then the third is the growth story, which was, where is this team going? And so we did the same exercise, 30 seconds, write down these six-word stories. And then they all shared those stories in their little tables. And what at least Adam said anecdotally was that the highest performing teams, not just the teams that were making the most in terms of global sales and being the most innovative, but also the teams that were the most coherent, were those that actually, when they shared their six-word stories, they were strikingly similar. But the teams that were underperforming and really struggling and they were worried about it within the NBA link were those within 30 seconds you could tell the team did not have any consensus around what is our story, what do we stand for, what value are we creating for the customer, and where are we going? And so something as powerful as a six-word story, which was really succinct, is best able oftentimes to capture what really is the meaning of an entity, a family, an organization. So I wanted to my goal is for you in a year's time, if I ever see you walking down the street, and I say, what did you remember in this session? It would be more than like these five, six-word stories. It would be a couple other things. So I created this talk with a hope that you could go back to your organization or even your family and hopefully be able to start using story much more effectively than perhaps you have. But to do that, you have to identify these misperceptions of story. Now, the first one I find the most frequent is that a lot of people feel like stories are communication or branding or marketing, but they're not. One of my favorite quotes is by Ben Horowitz, of Andreessen Horowitz, and he writes, "The company story is the company strategy. The story must explain why you exist. Why are we doing this? Why does the problem need to be solved? Why should you join the company? Why should you invest in us? Why should you buy a product from us?" And the story that you create, when it's concise, when it's clear, it addresses pretty much all of these questions. And they're found everywhere. It's not just communication, but there are stories on websites, in these blog posts and videos that we create, in the happy hours, the conversations we informally have through, obviously, social media, and even something as small as a six-word story exercise. So it's not just communication. The second misperception I often find, especially with engineers, although the engineers are the ones that tend to like this content the most because they see the science in it, is that they believe stories are kind of the opposite of data. But when you're leading and you have a point of view and you're trying to persuade, you have two tools, right? You have this data here and you have these stories, user stories, your own stories, your employee stories. And when you're in some context, like a board meeting versus a one-on-one versus a company treat, sometimes you're going to have 1 minute in front of someone and you'll go 80% into data and 20% on story. In other contexts, you're going to go 20% on data and 80% on story. So it really, these are two tools. So even though I showed you that initial slide to debunk the myth that data isn't story, because also large data sets create stories, the other way to think about it is you've got these two tools and you want both of them in your portfolio. Another way that a lot of times people remember this is, and I'd like you to do this too, think about when you make a 1 minute persuasive pitch to a board member, an employee, anyone, are you the type of person who usually leads with your point of view and then backs it up with data and then ends with a story? Or are you the kind of person that starts with a point of view, contextualizes it with a story, and then backs it up with data? Or do you hook people with story, back it up with data, end, and let them infer the point of view? Or are you a data-oriented person and then maybe come up with story and then follow it up? And by the way, as you think about this, you might have changed. I have a friend, Sheryl Sandberg, at Facebook, who used to always be point of view, data, no story. And over time, she's really changed, and she really has story, and then it's backed up with data, and then it ends with a point of view. I recently gave a talk at Genentech, and they said that their formula isn't up here, and they said, we're just data, data, data. We have no point of view nor any stories. So it might be different for you, but just quick raise of a hand, and I know there's different contortions. These are just four of the more common ones. Raise your hand if you're more point of view, data, story. Raise your hand if you're more point of view, story, data. Story, data, point of view. Data, story, point of view. Okay, so you're pretty well represented, although the lower left quadrant is by far the predominant. And so the way that to think about this is that even if you are story data point of view and that's what's natural for you or that's what your culture, your organization values, think about different ways of using these components because different audiences are persuaded for different reasons. And the last is that many people don't feel that there's an ROI to story. Just a quick anecdote. Bonobos, which was launched here as an online apparel company at Stanford many years ago, they were a data-oriented company where they could find out where there's pockets of product opportunities, and then they would launch them based on this data insight. One time they launched a jean called Bull Denim, and it was a great product. Their data said that there was no current product in that space of like good-fitting clothes for guys, but sales were underperforming. They asked customers what they loved about the jeans and learned that the men really loved to travel in them, so they kept hearing these epic stories of traveling with the like three people who bought the jeans. And so they renamed the travel jeans, each style for a different destination, and all they did was change and add about six or seven words to their exact same frame before. They added mid-weight travel jeans, and then they said, ideal for excursions to temperate zones near and far. Within 1 month, the entire category, the jean category, not just Bull Denim, increased in category sales from 7 to 15%. That was the only change, and the other categories didn't show a similar change. So there's ways to think about stories as providing context, and you can do A/B testing to understand what actually drives behavior. So I wanted to talk briefly about how to harness story before I kind of leave you with a few tips and maybe take a couple questions. So there's three really important ways to think about story. One is, how do you use stories to lead? And that stories with data are tools of power. And we have this class called Humor, Serious Business, and different types of stories. We find a lot of our CEOs really leverage humor in really effective ways. And so these stories don't have to be these meaningful, impactful stories. They can also be humorous or diffuse tension and create bonds. But they can be very powerful. The second is stories as actually strategic assets. And the third is stories as a way of living, a way of just making decisions for your family, for yourself, to create a more meaningful life, and using time with intent. I joked with Peter that I forgot that this was about power stories. So yesterday I was working on the talk, and I created a big talk actually around how do you use time in strategic ways. There's so much work done on meaning and money, like how to use money in meaningful ways, but there's not as much work on time. And so if anyone's interested in that, I'm happy to share it with you, that deck. But I'm not going to talk about those two. I'll talk in the remainder of this time much more on how you can think of stories as strategic assets. So what is a strategic asset as a story? In many stories we find in organizations is that stories are very tactical, but signature stories are strategic, and they're an asset that really merits investment and management. So my dad and I actually wrote an article together recently. It's called What is Your Signature Story? And we define signature stories as intriguing, authentic, involving stories with a strategic message that drives growth by enhancing the organization, the brand, and or the business strategy. So it often really three key ones that I talk a lot about are the purpose story. It illuminates what you stand for. The user is hero story, which is the value you create, and the growth story, where you're going. Now, when you ask people what are your strategic stories that are defining or signature, you often get at least leaders being able to rapidly, easily give you what are their signature stories are. And if they don't, then they're the people around them do. So a couple of examples. A CEO named Robert Hull, one of his strategic stories or signature stories that he says all the time is he was rejected 70 times by venture capitalists and weathered the 2008 financial crisis on his way to building a software company. And at one point, he actually had to suspend his salary and consider selling the company as it couldn't find a Series B investor. And this is right like the moment before, you know, he actually got Goldman to do a significant asset. But he tells that story again and again about like the highs and the lows of his career. Another example is Chiang, who's at Boxed. And he came out as a CEO with this idea of helping to pay for kids' colleges. He realized that basically what was so important to him was education. And then he found out that many of his employees couldn't even afford to hold after-work events because they needed to take care of their kids and they couldn't even send their kids to school. So he created an initiative and he said, if your child is someone who works at Boxed, it's not because of the lack of money that's going to prevent your kid from going to college or you. We're going to build a long-term business, and if you're along on the ride, we're going to basically pay for college for every single one of your kids. And that story gets told and retold within the company, and it's a real reason to not just go, but to stay. The harder thing to do is these signature stories about your company. So I wanted to breeze through three of them, and I'm going to have you write down six-word stories to capture your own work as well, just like with the NBA. So there's these purpose stories that clarify value and create differentiation. These user as hero stories that show how much empathy you have for your customer and how much value you really create. And these growth stories that elevate value and also increase pipeline. My favorite purpose story is Tom's, where the CEO often says, having a story is what separates us. People don't just wear our shoes, they tell our story. So I think we can all agree that Tom's shoes are really ugly shoes. Can we all agree? All right, most of you can agree that Tom's shoes are ugly shoes. Yet my daughter, who's 11, predominantly wears Tom's shoes, and she thinks they're actually good-looking shoes. And the reason she thinks they're good-looking shoes is because they have the story. Like, she knows that these very expensive shoes, they'll have, you know, another shoe donated to a child in a developing country, and that at some level makes her feel connected. And Tom's has done a tremendous job of actually executing on that promise. People want to be valued members of a winning team on an inspired mission. And you have to have every single one of those words working for you. And what I find at most companies is that inspired mission is not clear, there's no consensus, and it's not well understood, not just among the employees, but also the customer, the CEO and the leadership. Gallup ran a poll with over 1 million people last year and asked individuals, do you feel like you understand the mission of your company or the purpose of the company? 80% said no. Of the 20% who said yes, 75% said that they didn't care. And we have a lot of health data, a lot of productivity data to show that people work much harder, they get sick far less frequently when they feel connected to something that's meaningful or purposeful. It's just a tremendous waste. Stefanos has work with Jeff Pfeffer that shows that literally workplace environments are killing us. And I think the correlation between increased work and the health detriments that are happening is not completely independent from the fact that the work environments that we've set up for the people that work for us and with us are not healthy. And one of the problems is 80% don't know what the mission or the larger purpose of their company is. And of those who do, they don't personally feel themselves connected to it. So if you can't get to a place of feeling valued, feeling like you're on a team, and you don't have to be winning all the time, but you have to have a path toward winning, and then feel like you all know your role on the in the purpose and the mission, then you get these dramatic reduced hits to productivity and health. Steph says oftentimes, you win when everyone touches the ball. For those of you who don't follow basketball, he's a very important basketball player. And he talks a lot about this notion of what is a winning team, where everyone feels valued, everyone touches the ball, and we all feel like we're on the same team. You have to feel authentic when you share the story or that mission. People can tell when you aren't. And the problem right now is that brands often feel manufactured. Companies often feel manufactured. Certainly our politicians feel often quite manufactured. But people who we know, people whose story we understand and believe in, they don't. And they cut through. And we trust those people. And even those five signature stories told in six words makes you feel like you kind of know each of these five individuals. So the leaders that do this well often do not just articulate a purpose, but they do so in very authentic ways. So one of, sort of favorable, easy anecdote to point to is Dollar Shave Club, which is, as you know, sold for $1 billion to Unilever. With no marketing budget, basically, and very little money for PR, the CEO launched a video that explained their purpose and did it with a very clear brand personality, and that had made all the difference.
DollarShaveClub.com. What is DollarShaveClub.com? Well, for a dollar a month, we send high-quality razors right to your door. Yeah, a dollar. Are the blades any good? No. Our blades are f***ing great. Each razor has stainless steel blades, an aloe vera lubricating strip, and a pivot head. It's so gentle a toddler could use it. And do you like spending $20 a month on brand name razors? 19 go to Roger Federer. I'm good at tennis.
And do you think your razor needs a vibrating handle, a flashlight, a back scratcher, and 10 blades? Your handsome ass grandfather had one blade and polio.
Looking good, pop up!
Stop paying for shave tech you don't need. And stop forgetting to buy your blades every month. Alejandro and I are going to ship them right to you.
What
We're not just selling razors, we're also making new jobs. Alejandra, what were you doing last month?
Not working.
What are you doing now?
Working.
I'm no Vanderbilt, but this train makes hay. So stop forgetting to buy your blades every month and start deciding where you're gonna stack all those dollar bills I'm saving you. We are DollarShaveClub.com, and the party is on. I know karate, I know jiu-jitsu, I drive like a gangster when I'm coming to see you.
I always love Alejandra's face. Like, it's so funny. Like, I'm so embarrassed. This is my CEO. Anyway, from a financial perspective, they grew, and in large part it was due to this authentic, charismatic, story-filled leader who had a clear purpose. Just 30 seconds, really quickly. Write down, six words or less, your companies. And if you're changing companies right now, you can think about your last company or your hopeful future company. Six-word story about the company. Really anchor on what you think is the mission. So if you were here with your senior team, hopefully they're all going to write down the same type of six words. Go ahead, 30 seconds. It could be like, do no evil or whatever if you're Google or, you know. It doesn't have to be six words. All right. And by the way, you can do this with your team. Like, this takes all of a minute and a half, and the type of insights is just remarkable. The second signature story that's really important to nail down is this user as hero story. And all of the individuals that are trained in design thinking here at Stanford know how to do this really well. A lot of technology companies do too. But brands too often make the mistake of trying to be the hero. Your customers, your users are the hero. But now LinkedIn and Facebook and YouTube, all of these companies have done a really good job, not of marketing, but of collecting these user stories and then banking them on these websites. All of these websites I'm showing you have hundreds of thousands of user stories, which all have the exact same arc, which is ordinary person faces extraordinary odds to achieve something quite remarkable by means of Google or YouTube or Facebook or LinkedIn. Exact same arc. A good example of this was Google, who does not believe in marketing. They don't hire anyone with marketing in the title, maybe now, but barely. And they don't think they're good communicators, or they don't believe in brand. So it's really frustrating for them when they come up with a really strong product made by engineers and it doesn't take off. Because they don't believe in marketing, so they can't yell louder. And when they do, they yell about features, and that doesn't change people's behavior. One day, the creative head, Robert Wong, went to his team and said, we've got to make Google Chrome take off. It's a better product than other search engines. No one's adopting it. Why not? And one of the people in the room basically storyboarded out his story, and this is what it looks like.
Thank you.
So that ad then became their Super Bowl ad, and now they're basically the best marketers I know. It also increased, to their fault. And they have this incredible campaign around it. It's all users, hero stories. Daniel Lee, who did work at Google, you know, you saw that story wasn't about Google Chrome. It was about, you know, Picasa and YouTube and Gmail and all of these different things. So the hero was Daniel Lee, and Google Chrome was just kind of a background player. And the thing that's interesting is that it led to a 6% uptick in Google Chrome downloads in the 1 week after the launch of this. So it had a dramatic impact. So again, 30 seconds of who's your customer? You can just think of one person if you want. And how do you help make them the hero of their story? In this case, Daniel Lee was a better dad because of Google products. And that really made him a hero. I have a girlfriend in the back who's an entrepreneur, Wendy Riker, who does these really remarkable things with all of her kids, making her kids feel like they are heroes of their own story. So, oops, sorry about that. All right, 30 seconds, write down the name of your user or your customer or whatever, and just write down a single six-word story where you think you could help make them the hero of their story in some way. Last, the growth story, knowing where you're going. My favorite anecdote here is Coca-Cola, where 3 or 4 years ago, they had no idea how to leverage social and digital media, and all their communication wasn't working. And so they got this book that we wrote called The Dragonfly Effect. My husband and I wrote this book together, mostly to inspire kids to do good things in the world. We wanted them to be like Kennedy kids, but without the drinking issues. And so we wrote a book, you know, and also like if anything happened to us, you know, they would see a dragonfly and knew like we were connected to them. So it was a very meaningful endeavor. But weirdly, it got picked up by all these for-profit companies that wanted to make change in the world. And this is like the least inspirational anecdote, but it's a super fun anecdote because, you know, Coke is sugar water. But it was still a really interesting case. They did not know how to connect to teens globally, harnessing social and digital media. So they used this design thinking approach, saying our single focus goal, which is the key part, you know, what is your purpose in this campaign, was very clear, connect to teens globally, harnessing social and digital media. And then instead of taking $350,000 and giving it to their marketing team, they created seven groups of 50 grand and gave it to seven different teams of marketing and non-marketing people and said, go get this goal. And six of the teams bombed. They created apps and screensavers, but one of the teams approached their goal.
Thank you.
So that was an organic tweet. They didn't SEO this. But that hit 20 million views in 2 weeks. The blog comments were 95% positive, 50% English, and 50% not English. But what was interesting about this is that all these people started writing in saying, I want a Coke happiness machine on my campus and my company. And they originally started kind of throwing away these notes and emails, but they realized that this actually fundamentally changed how they thought of themselves as a growth company. They all anchored on this six-word story of creating surprising moments of authentic happiness. And that completely transformed how they spent their budget. And the other reason this is an interesting story is that if you look at their budget, what they do is they spend 70% on what actually works, which drives revenue. But 20% of what they're doing, all of their content, and most interesting companies are basically now editors of magazines. They're not really CPG companies. But 20% of their marketing budget goes to very news stories, and 10% go to customer-generated, co-created stories. And then they test each of these stories, and some of the 20% go into the subsequent year 70%. Some of the 10% customer-generated stories go into the 20% new initiatives. So 30 seconds, just write your six-word story, where you're going, down, 6 words or less. Okay, so I wanted to end with a couple of things that I hope you do. One, I am on next week. I hope you think more about the stories you're using to lead, the stories that your company may be banking as assets, and even thinking about what stories you're sharing at the dinner table instead of what you do today. Instead, could you say, share a story of what happened? And we started doing that with our three young kids, and they started taking much bigger risks because they were really excited to come home and share a story of what they did that sidestepped a bully or would make us sort of take our breath away. And it fundamentally changed the way our family lives. Now every year we move away for 4 months to do a family sabbatical in New York or Sweden or Stockholm. By the way, we want to go to South America next, so if anyone has any connections, let us know. But the reason is because you don't remember the day-to-day. You only remember when you move, physical dislocation. You only remember those moments you're uncomfortable. Also, it was really fun because they don't have any friends in other places, so they're forced to be with us. So there's a lot of reasons to think about how do you think of creative life design anchored on the stories that you could bring about this year, or what stories have defined your last year. When we ask this to our students and our subjects, they don't remember anything about last year. It's not just my class that they don't remember, it's everything. But they remember stories. So I hope you audit your current stories, both internally for your employees as well as externally. And it's really easy to do, just taking inventory of how consistent and coherent they are. I hope you get clear on three, your purpose story, your user as hero and empathy story, and your growth story. I hope you start banking your stories. Maybe it's on a website, or maybe it's just through Google Slides. They're assets, and if you anchor on those true stories, the bold stories, those stories that are distinct, relevant to different audiences, memorable so they stick over time, evergreen so they grow in value over time, and they depict something bigger, some inspired mission that connotes and conveys meaning. And then you do that every 5 or 10 years as the story of our lives changes. I think your life will be much more meaningful. So I'll end with my favorite quote, which is, tell me the facts and I'll learn. Tell me the truth and I'll believe. But tell me a story and it will live in my heart forever. Thank you. Thank you.